In case you missed it, officially into the second month of 2016. Can you believe that 2016, the new year, is already 1/12th over? In fact, we're already a full week into the month of February. Kind of hard to believe, isn't it? This year is, for me, is passing pretty quickly. A quick question for you, and be honest with me, if you will. How many of you, with a show of hands, set a New Year's resolution for yourself at the beginning of this year that you are still tracking with? Okay, we got four or five of you. Okay, now I've never professed of being a person who has the spiritual gift of prophecy, but I kind of called that one. I said back at the beginning of the year that most of us who set a New Year's resolution for ourselves would probably have completely fallen off the wagon before the end of January. Here we are at the end of the first week of February, and we've got about four or five people in the room that are still tracking with their resolutions. Now, let me ask you another question, in all honesty here. How many of you, with a show of hands, know that there is something about yourself, something about your life, your quirks, your habits, your hang-ups, that you really need to change? Anyone? Okay. Anyone sitting next to someone who has a habit that needs to change? Okay. All right. Keep your elbows down. That was a hands-up thing, right? Okay. All right. Good. So this is what I figured. You see, the truth is that most of us, I realize, most of us, I believe, have some sort of habit, some sort of life pattern, something in our lives that needs to change. For better or for worse, we know that we would be better for losing that habit or giving something up in our lives. The problem for most of us is that as we make our way through life and we attempt to make change, and this is, you know, New Year's resolutions notwithstanding, most of the time when we try to make change, we try to make change sort of from the outside in. We try to curb our behavior, and we hope that ultimately that will change the things in our lives that we need to change. I want to kind of throw out here to you today something that I believe, and that is that I believe that most of the changes that we need to make are actually far less based on external things and more internal. In fact, if we really want to have success in making real changes, lifelong changes in our lives, we need to actually look at what's going on the inside of our hearts, on the inside of our lives, on the insides of our mind. That's really where a lot of our change needs to take place. We'll have a far better chance of success if we start from the inside and work our way out as opposed to starting on the outside and trying to make our changes. You know, as we wrap up this series today, Seeing Through the Fog, we're going to spend some time today exploring the topic of addictions. Now, most of us probably have specific things that come to mind when we think about addictions or addictive behavior. When we hear the word addiction, we naturally start thinking about things such as alcohol or drugs or maybe gambling. Those are sort of the, you know, that's the top three probably that you think of when you think about addictions. And then we might have sort of a secondary list. It might include things like smoking or perhaps overeating or shopping. You know, those are things that we might think about as having addictive tendencies or being addictive behavior. But clinical research actually demonstrates that addictions and addictive behavior really reaches into pretty much every aspect of our lives as human beings. Every nook, every cranny, every corner of who we are, there are things that can creep up and be addictive to us. This can include things such as work, exercise, food, sex, television, video games, social media, mobile phones, even sports. Yes, I'll go so far as to say on Super Bowl Sunday that watching sports can actually be an addiction. Don't judge me yet, okay? Wait till you see how I act when I watch the football game this afternoon. Then you can judge me. Now, most of us, when we think about addictions and addictive behavior, we naturally think primarily about those things that have destructive consequences to our lives, the things that are most likely to do damage to our physical health or to our relationships. Clearly, those things are things that that can be the most quick to take us down when we start walking into addictive behavior. Nobody ever gets out of bed and says, you know, I'm going to start acting like an addict today. You know, I got up this morning, I looked in the mirror, My skin's looking pretty good. My teeth are nice. I think I'm going to go smoke some crystal meth. Because I know what that'll do to my skin and to my teeth. I saw a series of pictures on the internet this week. It was documenting people, what had happened to their physical appearance after 1 year of smoking crystal meth. It was unbelievable. And I guarantee you that not one of those people got up one morning and said, you know what? I'm a pretty good looking person. I think I would like to look like my face had caved in and rot all my teeth out. So I'm going to go smoke some crystal meth. You know, nobody ever goes and takes their first cigarette and says, you know what, I'm going to smoke a cigarette today, and I hope that after I smoke this cigarette, I'm going to get addicted. And eventually, I'm going to get emphysema or lung cancer, and I'm going to die 10 or 12 years before I probably should die. That's what I'm longing for. Nobody sets out that way, but a lot of people actually do it, you know? Nobody ever looks in the mirror and says, you know, I'd really like to set the goal of being extraordinarily overweight. Obese is really where I want to go. Like if I can set myself up for having diabetes or having some sort of heart attack or heart disease, that's where I want to go. Or you know what? I think what I'm going to start doing is I'm going to start eating a ton at every meal. And then when I'm done, I'm going to go to the bathroom, put my finger down my throat and puke it all up. Because binging and purging sounds like such a wonderful way to live one's life, doesn't it? Now, nobody ever gets up and starts off their day that way, yet many people track down that road. You know, no one that I know ever gets up and says, you know, I think what I'm going to do is get onto the internet and I'm going to type www.nakedsomething and really wreck my marriage. You know, I really think that there's some stuff on the internet that I could look at today and I could ruin everything that I've invested in my marriage and my family life. No one ever, you know, starts out on a day like today, Super Bowl Sunday, and says, you know what, that Cam Newton guy, he seems pretty special. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a $20 bet on the Super Bowl today, and what I hope happens is I hope the thrill, win or lose, is so great that I get addicted to gambling. And then once I'm addicted, I'm going to gamble away my whole life savings. I'm going to get my house repossessed, my car repossessed, my wife is going to leave me, and eventually some guy named Guido is going to come knock on my doors and want to break my kneecaps. You know, nobody starts out that way, yet so many people track down that road. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people every day step through a doorway of addiction into a road that is so foggy they wonder if they'll ever see the light. Now, those are obviously very destructive things, and those are the things that we most often think about when we think about addictions, but how about all the things, those behaviors, those habits, those addictions that we have that on the surface level don't even necessarily look that bad. In fact, in some cases, if you look at them culturally, they look to be pretty good things. Things that might actually be good for you. Like, you know, what if you're addicted to making your kids happy? Like, shouldn't everybody want to be a good parent? Isn't that one of our goals, to raise happy kids? But what if you're addicted to making your kids happy? Or, you know, what if you're addicted to being successful, making lots of money or saving lots of money? Like, shouldn't we strive to be excellent workers in the workplace, representing God in all that we do? And is there anything wrong with saving up a few pennies for a rainy day? But can we become addicted to those things? Or, you know, how about being addicted to being physically fit? You know, being an amazing specimen of health and beauty, kind of like me. I'm not really addicted to it, but I know that some of you strive for that. I mean, is there any value in being a good steward of the body, the one and only body that God has given to us? See, I believe that all of us in some area of our life have some addiction. We have something that we have grabbed hold of as a way of filling a void or filling a hole in our lives. And whether we realize it or not, we've stepped into something that ultimately may be preventing us from reaching our full potential for God, becoming the person that he's ultimately designed us to be, and maybe even experiencing life the way that he designed us to experience life. You know, sometimes our addictions are things that we know are not good for us. Every one of you who smokes cigarettes here, you don't need me to stand down here and tell you that smoking isn't good for you. You know that it's not good for you, yet you do it anyway. There's not a person in this room that doesn't know that overeating is not good for you, yet so many of us still do it. Sometimes our addictions are things that we know are not good for us. We just kind of pretend that they're not addictions, or we kind of deny that they are. But what about all the other stuff that we do that we don't even realize we're addicted to? All the things that we've grabbed hold of in our lives, and we have addictive tendencies or addictive habits, patterns in our lives. We don't even realize what we're addicted to. Romans chapter 7, Paul the Apostle writes this. He says, I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. Now, I want you to take in mind who's writing this statement here. This is Paul the Apostle, who incidentally wrote about two-thirds of the New Testament of the Bible, the guy who was probably the greatest Christian that ever walked the planet. This guy, most of what we know about following Jesus came from his pen. He wrote it down, or he dictated it to somebody. Like, this guy is the one that set the bar for us. And he wrote this after he was following Jesus, not before he was following Jesus. This isn't the pre-saved Paul. This is the Paul who'd already been following Jesus for some time, who had started a number of churches. This was the veteran Christian Paul who says, I do stuff I shouldn't do, even though I don't want to do it. Is it just me, or can anyone else relate to this very, very well? There's stuff I do that I don't want to do, yet I often do it. How many of you left me hanging there? Anyone else relate to this at all? Okay, thank you. Now, let's look at where Paul continues. He says, I love God's law with all my heart. Pause. What he means there is, I know that what God wants for me is what's best for me. I know that what God wants for me is what's best for me, and that's ultimately what I want to do. But, he says, there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. Now, we talked about this in the first week of our series, this mental war, the mental battle, the war that goes on between our ears. And we talked about two strategies that we need to employ to fight this battle. We need to feed our mind, and we need to focus our mind. We need to feed our mind. We need to focus our mind. If you weren't here with us the first week of this series, you need to click onto our website, grasslandschurch.com, and you need to watch that message. If you were here with us the first week of that series, this series, and you have no idea what I'm talking about, it means you were sleeping through my sermon. You need to click onto our website and go back and watch this message. It was the foundation for everything that we've looked at up to this point. Okay? We've got to feed our mind the right things. We've got to focus our mind on the right things if we're going to win this battle. Paul continues. He says, this power, the one that he's struggling with, makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. The sin is the stuff that he's doing that he shouldn't be doing. The stuff he's done that he shouldn't have done. The stuff he knows he's probably going to do that he shouldn't do. And he continues. He says, oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Now, as we approach this topic of addiction, we can look at it from one of two angles. Either we can stand here and we can say, okay, that's me. What Paul says there, who Paul describes when he's talking about himself, that's me. I do stuff I shouldn't do. I've been doing stuff I shouldn't be doing. I somehow can't seem to stop doing the things that I don't want to do, and the things that I know I'm supposed to do, I can't start doing. Or you can sit here and you can pretend that that's somebody else. That's not you. Okay? Maybe you don't think that you're doing things that you shouldn't be doing, or you haven't done stuff that you shouldn't do. Maybe that's you. Now, if you're in the first camp, if you're a person that identifies with Paul and you know there's stuff in your life that you shouldn't be doing, you know you've got these tendencies, you keep waging this battle and you keep losing this war in your mind and doing stuff that you know you shouldn't be doing, I'm going to talk to you in just a few minutes. I'm going to share with you more of what Paul says on this topic, even talk about what Jesus said on this topic. But for those of you who are sitting here this morning who are completely unsure of whether or not this actually applies to you, or whether or not you have an addiction, or maybe you're just in denial, what I want to do is I want to highlight some indicators for you that might shine a light on an area of your life where you might actually have addictive behaviors, where you might have an addiction, something that really does need to change. Here are four key indicators that you may have an addiction. If you're a note taker, you can write this down. Number one, something has become a part of my identity. Something has become a part of my identity. For better or for worse, if there's something in your life that consumes much of your time, much of your attention, So much so that people would say that you are defined by that thing, you may have an addiction. But what about a person whose identity is wrapped up in their desire to be physically fit, to exercise, to eat healthy? Like, listen, if you spend more time at the gym than the people who work at the gym, right? If every time you're with your friends or your family or your neighbors or your coworkers, every conversation comes around to the new workout routine you're on, the new diet that you are on. If every conversation with your friends, your neighbors, your family, your colleagues is you wanting to coach them on how they can be healthier and more physically fit. If every time you walk by a mirror, you pause to flex or check your thigh gap, whatever that's all about, I'm simply saying then you might have an addiction, because here's what happens, is that the people who know you, the people who love you, will tell you that a big part of your identity is your need to be physically fit. And if it's a big part of your identity, it may be a red flag to an addiction. Okay, here's the second warning sign for you. Second red flag. Any threat to my thing becomes a threat to me. Any threat to my thing, this thing that is a part of my identity, if it's threatened to be taken away, it's actually a personal threat to me. Let me explain this one. If there's something in your life that's so important to you that you imagine you would probably die if it was taken away, or you would rather die if it was taken away, you may have an addiction. Smokers, I want to pick on you for just a minute, okay? Because smokers, a big part of your identity as a smoker is being a smoker, and you gravitate towards other smokers so that you can go and smoke together. And smokers have been losing the battle over the last, you know, couple of decades over where you can smoke and when you can smoke. To quote Dennis Leary, it won't be long before the only place you'll be allowed to smoke is in your home, in your bedroom, in your bed, under the covers. It's the only place you're going to be allowed to smoke, and yet you'll still fight for that right, because if someone threatens to take that away from you, it's taking away a part of your identity. Now, smokers, I know that you think I'm picking on you. I smoked for many years of my life, from the time I was about 14 until I was 29 years old. I know the battle. I know what it's like. I know what it's like to be identified as a smoker, and I know what it's like to have it taken away or to give it up. I know that it's a big part of your identity, and I also know that it's one of those things that when it's threatened to be taken away, you're willing to fight hard for it. You see it as a huge personal threat. How about this one? This one might be a little bit closer to home for some of you. What about your cell phone? Did he really go there? Yes, he did. If you face the prospect of having your cell phone taken away, would that be a personal threat to you? Think about it. Tim Ling, who's playing the keyboard down here, he leads our student ministries. I'm not picking on Tim. Wait, you got to listen to the story. Okay, Tim leads our students, our high school students, and last year, Tim started a policy that at the beginning of their youth time, all of the students deposited their phones into a basket. Needless to say, the high school students did not love that. I wonder, how many of you would stop coming to Grassland services on Sunday morning if we decided to collect all your phones at the door before you came in? See, there are some of you who can't get through a meal without checking your phone. Checking your text messages, checking your email, checking your Instagram likes, checking your Facebook status to see if people have commented on it. I have meetings with some of you, and I am blown away by how we're having a conversation face-to-face, and yet every time your phone goes bing, bing, or cock-a-doodle-doo, or whatever it does, because some of you have some goofy ringtones on your phones, you got to look at it. You got to know who's connecting with you, who wants to touch you digitally in some way. It's weird. And it's some of the same of you who can't get through an hour-long church service on Sunday mornings without checking your phones 20 times. You don't think I can see you? No, Pastor, I'm just reading my Bible on my phone. No, you're not. You're a liar. Don't lie at church. It's not good for you, okay? I'm not going to take your phones when you come in on a Sunday morning. But, listen, if having your phone or having some sort of disconnection from digital media seems like a personal threat to you, you may have an addiction. Here's the third red flag. I am willing to lose something important in order to keep my thing. I am willing to lose or give up something important in order to keep my thing. We had some neighbors live next door to us when we lived in Ontario. We were in a semi-detached house, a duplex, and they were in the other half of our duplex. We didn't ever get to know them very well. There was a Chinese family, three generations. It was an elderly couple, probably in their 70s, and then a middle-aged couple. The man was the son of that couple, and then they had their two teenage sons. The middle-aged couple had two teenage sons that lived with them. And we lived next door to them for maybe about a year and a half, 2 years, and during the time that we were living there next door to them, one day they disappeared. Like, literally just vanished. The cars were in the driveway. The house still looked like someone was living there, but there was clearly no one home. And we had people that were coming to our door, knocking on the door, asking us if we'd seen them or if we knew anything about where they were. We didn't know anything. We were getting phone calls for them. It was the strangest thing. Now, our neighbor who lived on the other side of them was a police officer. He'd been there for much longer than we had, and he had some personal connection with them. And he'd had some contact with that man's brother and sister. And this is what we learned, is that the middle-aged man had a gambling addiction. In fact, it didn't surprise us when we found this out, because we had seen over the time that we'd been there, on Friday nights, often a limousine from one of the Niagara casinos would pick him up on Friday night and return him home on Sunday evening. It was the greater Toronto area, and weird people do weird things. We thought it was a weird thing, but hey, you know, to each his own. But he was doing this on a pretty regular basis, and eventually what we noticed had happened is that they had closed down a business that they owned. They owned a banquet hall, and they closed down the business, and there were people always home. There was never anyone working, and then all of a sudden, boom, they just disappeared. And what we found out was that this man's gambling addiction had led him to borrowing large sums of money from the Chinese mafia, upwards of a couple $100,000. And in the middle of the night, they packed up, and they left the country for fear of their lives. The people that were coming and knocking on our door asking us if we'd seen them were mafia people. They were trying to find this family, find this man. This was Guido. I don't think there's any Chinese people named Guido, but this was their Guido coming to break the kneecaps. And it was amazing to the family as the brother and the sister of this man came over and started preparing the house, cleaning it out to sell it. Everyone was just, you know, completely baffled by the fact that this man had been willing to risk so much for the sake of gambling. He gave up so much. He lost so much. He lost his home. He lost his freedom, really, having to go into hiding to make sure that he didn't lose his life. It was crazy. It was a very interesting season, and I'd never actually, you see those things in the movies, but they actually happen in real life. Like, how many of us have something in our life that we're willing to risk something important to us to hang on to? You know, how many men have I known who are willing to risk everything they've invested in their marriage and their family life for the sake of looking at a few inappropriate images on their computer? I've seen marriages come apart, completely fall apart because of this thing, and a man's willing to give up so much. I've seen men, I'm picking on men, I am one, so I know how it works, but I've seen so many men get so wrapped up in their careers and their need to make money and their need to achieve that they give up life with their family. They miss their kids growing up. They miss opportunities to be there with their family, with their spouse for years, for decades sometimes, because they've got this job, this career that they need to invest in. And I see it all the time. People get engaged in things and prioritize things that prevent them from being able to be connected in the church family. You know, whether it's a job thing or a kid's activity, we prioritize all kinds of things that we don't realize have become habit-forming, but we're unwilling to change our schedule. We can't give up that kid's thing or that work thing to actually attend a church service on Sunday morning or to participate in a community group during the week or to be involved in some way. We've got these things that just grab hold of us and we get sucked into this vortex. We're willing to risk something great for the sake of holding on to that thing. We might have an addiction. Here's number four, the fourth indicator that you might have an addiction. You ease personal pain and disappointment by giving in to that thing or going back to that thing. Like, there's no doubt that all of us have areas of our life, things that haven't turned out the way that we thought they would or we hoped they would. Maybe relationships have broken down. Maybe our health isn't good. Maybe our finances aren't good. And then we find these things that sort of temporarily make us feel better. And we start going to those things. And eventually, those things become the thing that we go to all the time to satisfy that vacancy or that void that we have in our lives. You know, I have a good friend who's an alcoholic. And he said to me one time, he said, "You know you have an addiction when every time you plan something for yourself or for your family to do, you have to figure out a way to work in your next fix." See, when you're addicted to something like a substance, alcohol or drugs or even smoking, you know that nothing satisfies the need, the urge, eases the pain like getting that next fix. But you don't always think about that in terms of exercise or eating or making money or spending money, things that become addictive behaviors. We don't see them in the same light. And my friend said, you know, every time I plan something, I remember walking through this season with him. Whenever we went to play golf or we have a softball game, he always had to have a time and a place where there was access to beer. You know, whenever there was a family outing or even church gatherings, he always had to make sure that there was some way that he could get his fix for beer when we had that event. And he finally said to me, he says, "I know this is a problem because it's the first thing I think about. Oh, we're going to have a men's retreat? Where am I going to get the beer? Oh, we're going to go over to my in-law's house for Thanksgiving? Who's bringing the beer?" And he said, eventually I realized this was a problem. Let me ask you a question. Whenever you think about doing something, scheduling something, going away and doing something, plan your weekend, what's that thing that you always have to sort of figure out how to work in to the schedule? You know, is it got to make sure that when we take a vacation, there's a fitness room at the hotel? Because I got to have my hour on the treadmill. Or there's got to be free Wi-Fi. I can't be disconnected from Facebook or Twitter for the whole weekend, can I? I've got to have that. Got to make sure it's there. Check this list. Check these warning signs. If any of these things ring true for you, you might have an addiction. If you're being honest with yourself, I bet that at some point in time in your life, somebody has actually told you, "You know, I think you might be addicted to that." And you're, no, I'm not addicted. It's just the way that I'm wired. It's just the way that God made me. I just really enjoy it. Of course you do. You enjoy it because it satisfies a need. It fills a void, a hole that you have in your life. We know deep down that we have a cycle in our life that needs to be broken. Listen, you cannot resort to chocolate to solve all your problems in life. Sorry, ladies. I know some of you, that's a very painful thing to hear. You can't rely on pornography to fill the void in your life and in your relationships. You can't just trade your cigarettes for vapor smokes, because you're not really breaking the cycle. You're just trading one addiction for another. The problem is not really solved. You need to break the cycle. And the cycle can only be broken with an inside-out change. It's not about changing your behavior as much as it is about changing your heart. Here's the deal. Addiction, in whatever form it is really just a symptom of another disease that affects all of us. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 2, we've read this verse several times in this series. Paul says, "Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things." He's basically saying, focus on things that are eternal, things that will last forever. Don't focus on the stuff that only lasts for a short while we're living this life. He continues in verse 5 to say, "Put to death, kill it, execute it, break the cycle, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, which is idolatry." There's another translation of this verse that says the word covetousness. Covetousness, coveting something, is desiring something, needing something that you don't have, or maybe that you don't even deserve, something you're not even entitled to, but you need to have it. Addiction is really just a symptom of idolatry. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, I don't have idols. Like, I don't have like a shrine in my house that I bow down and I worship to. Maybe the mirror is your shrine if you're like me. Okay? But you know what? I know, we don't think about things like idols in our culture today the way that, certainly the way that, Paul would have when he wrote this passage. Let me explain it to you the way that Jesus explains it. In Mark chapter 10, verse 7, as Jesus was starting out on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked. "Only God is truly good, but to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. You must not cheat anyone. Honor your father and mother." Jesus says, "Here are all the rules. Follow the rules. Check off the boxes." This guy gets excited. He says, "Teacher, I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young." Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. "There's still one thing you haven't done," he told him. "Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." At this, the man's face fell and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Now, I don't know if you've heard this story before. What's going to happen from here is Jesus is going to go on and explain just how difficult it is for a rich person to get to heaven. And this passage is often used to teach us about the dangers of loving money or having an inappropriate priority to money and worldly possessions. But I think that there's a greater message here about what Jesus is teaching us. I think that what Jesus wants us to know is that anything that might come between us and our willingness to put him first is ultimately an idol. Anything that we prioritize ahead of our relationship with God, anything that we're not willing to give up for Jesus is an idol. And anything that comes before Jesus that we put our trust in, that we put our hope in, that we count on to satisfy us, to ease our pain, to give us comfort, to elevate our self-worth, anything that we take, that we put onto the throne of our lives is just a false substitute for Jesus. It's counterfeit. It's an idol. In Romans chapter 7, Paul, this is the continuation of the passage we read earlier. He says, "Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death?" Thank God the answer is Jesus Christ, our Lord. See, Jesus is the one with the real power to ease our pain, to comfort us in our time of need, to fill the void in our lives. All those things that we use to satisfy ourselves, to give us our next fix, they are just counterfeit. Anything that we place onto the throne of our life that's not Jesus is just an idol. You see, when Jesus told that rich young man to sell all he possessed before he came to follow Jesus, I believe that Jesus was basically saying, "I need to take the throne of your life. I need the main seat, but there's already something in it. And I need you to empty the seat so that I can have a seat." Let me ask you a question. If you were to find Jesus out on the street today, which would be really cool if you did, and please call me if you do. Okay, but if you went to Jesus and you asked him the same question, "Hey, Jesus, what do I need to do?" And Jesus says, "Well, you know, I mean, you're a pretty good person. You even went to church today. Good on you. But hey, there's this one thing that I think you need to check before you actually commit to me." What would he say to you? Like, I doubt very seriously that Jesus would tell you the same thing that he told this rich young man. I don't think he would tell you, "You need to go sell everything that you own and give all the money to the poor." I don't think that that's what he'd say. I think you would say, "You've got something in my seat. Is it your exercise? Is it your alcohol? Is it your relationship with your family? Is it your career? Is it your job? Is it food? Is it your cell phone? What is it that's in the seat?" Jesus is going to stand there and wait for you to clear off the throne of your life before he gets on it. Trust me, he's not going to sit on your cell phone. It's really uncomfortable. He wants and he needs and he deserves the place. Anything that you have on the throne that is not the king is not the real thing. It is just counterfeit. It's so easy for us to let these things creep into a place of priority in our lives. Many of them we wouldn't even necessarily peg as being bad things. A cell phone is not a bad thing. Chips and salsa is not a bad thing. It's not. But when it becomes a replacement for filling the void, filling the hole, easing the pain, providing the satisfaction that we're looking for in life, when we've replaced Jesus with that thing, then we have an idol and we might have an addiction. Now, I'm going to wrap things up. Now we're going to respond in just a moment with some singing. I'm going to give you a couple things that I want you to think about here. The first one is simply a disclaimer, okay? When it relates to addictions, if you are a person that struggles with any sort of substance abuse addiction, drugs, alcohol, if pornography or gambling is something that you are wrapped up in and you're not sure how to break that cycle in your life, you need to seek professional help. I'm not a professional at helping people break the cycle of those things, but I know people who are, and I can point you in the right direction to help you get the professional help that you need. And so you need to be honest and come clean and let us know how we can walk that journey with you. This is a grace community. We're not going to ostracize you because you gamble or because you look at pornography or because you've got an addiction to narcotics or whatever. We don't want to leave you in that place. We want to see you overcome that. We want to see you break that cycle in your life. So we want to go on the journey with you. We're not going to kick you out of our church because you're a sick person. Because the church is for sick people, for people who got issues. We've all got our own issues. The person sitting next to you has got some pretty big issues. But you've got your own issues. And if your issues need professional help, you need to let us know so that we can help you and go on that journey with you. Talk to me in private, send me an email, call me, whatever, and we'll help you out with that. However, I do want to give you a very practical thing or a couple of very practical things that I think that you can do to help break some cycles in your life and overcome addictions if you're a person that knows you've got something that you need to break, okay? Here's another little story about Jesus. Matthew chapter 17 at verse 14, there's a guy that has a son who's demon-possessed, and he comes up to Jesus. He says, the text says, a man came and knelt before Jesus and said, Lord, have mercy on my son. He has seizures and suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. So I brought him to your disciples, but they couldn't heal him. Jesus said, you faithless and perverse people. Jesus is so nice. He's mad at his disciples. Can you tell? How long must I be with you? How long must I put up with you? Bring your boy here to me. Then Jesus rebuked the demon in the boy, and it left him. From that moment, the boy was well. Now, obviously, Jesus is a little frustrated with his disciples here. And I want to highlight a couple of the words that he used to describe his disciples who were unable to cast out this demon. He calls them faithless and perverse. What does he mean by that? Well, by faithless, he simply means that they lack trust in God. They're lacking trust. Trust is the center of every healthy relationship. They don't have a healthy relationship with God because they don't trust that God can solve the problem that they are trying to address. And secondly, he calls them perverse, which means that they're trusting too much in their own power. They're not trusting enough in God. They're faithless. They're perverse because they're trusting too much in the humanness and in the world and in the things that the world puts value in. Now take a look at what happens next in the story. Verse 19. Afterward, the disciples asked Jesus privately, hey, Jesus, why couldn't we cast out that demon? You don't have enough faith, Jesus told them. I tell you the truth, if you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, get that he's saying they have less than that, you could move this mountain. Tell it to move from here to there and it would move. Nothing would be impossible. This kind of demon won't leave except by prayer and fasting. Jesus gives two keys here that I believe that can help us overcome the demons in our lives. Prayer and fasting. This demon won't leave without prayer and fasting. First off, prayer helps us build our trust in God, right? Jesus said you don't have enough faith. You lack trust. Prayer helps us build trust in God. Why? Because we're spending personal time with God. When we're praying, You can't build trust in a relationship if you don't spend time with a person. God wants you to spend time with him in prayer to build trust, to allow him to build your faith. Secondly, fasting breaks the bond of trust that we have in our idols. Now, I know when we think of fasting, we think of refraining from food. You fast by not eating. But we can also fast from the things that tend to be our go-to fixes in life. Maybe we need a fast from the gym. Maybe we need a fast from social media. Maybe we need a fast from watching television. Maybe we need a fast from video games. Maybe we need a fast from food. We need to break the bond that we've created, this relationship we have with this thing, and focus on our relationship with God. Now, this Wednesday, interestingly, is the 10th of February. And this week starts Lent, the first day of Lent. Now, if you come from a Catholic background or an Orthodox background, you probably have some experience with Lent. Lent is a tradition that dates back to the 300s. It's a church tradition. It's not anywhere in the Bible, but traditionally what Lent would be is it would be a time where people give something up for 6 weeks, basically until Easter, as a way of penance, right? Maybe you've practiced Lent before. Maybe you gave up chocolate, or you gave up smoking, or you gave up watching TV or something of that nature, right? And so what I want to challenge you to do is just capitalize on the fact that Lent is here. We're not commanded anywhere in the Bible to practice Lent, but I think it's a great opportunity and a perfect time for you to say, hey, you know what? There's something I need to fast from, and I need to use this 40 days, this 6 weeks of Lent, as a time of prayer and fasting, building my relationship with God and breaking the relationship that I have with this thing that I keep going to. I need to build my relationship with God in prayer, and I need to break the bond of trust that I have in this thing. When you came in this morning, everyone got one of these cards, except for those of you who are late. You got it after you came in. We're going to play a video for you here in just a moment. And as this video plays and as we respond in song this morning, I'm going to encourage you to write down on this piece of paper that thing that you know you need to break a bond with. And commit to this Lenten season, breaking that bond and committing to prayer. You can put your name on it or your email address on it if you want, or you can just write down the thing. Here's what I'm going to do. When we have our offering at the end of our service together today, I'm going to take these cards. And what I'm going to commit to doing is I'm going to commit to 40 days of praying for the things that you are committing to break a bond with. I'm going to send out an email every day for 40 days with a prayer that we can pray together. You may not even know how to pray for the things that you need to pray for. I'll help you with that. If you're receiving our weekly e-news, you're already on the list. If you're not receiving our weekly e-news, use your Connect card to sign up for that today, and you'll get the emails. But for 40 days, from this Wednesday until Easter, I will pray for these things for you, whether I know your name or not, and I will send you an email with a prayer that you can pray along with me so that we can break the bond of trust that we have with these addictions, with these idols that are taking the place that God so rightly deserves in our lives. You can take those cards out as we roll this video for you here. You can fill them out, and then we'll have our offering in just a few minutes, and you can give those to us at that time.
There's a father when your father walks away, a friend when no one else knows your name, a light that shines when all the world goes dark, a hand that holds you when you fall apart. His name is Healer of your deepest scars, Father of your broken heart. His name is Mercy, Power, Freedom, fall before his mighty hand. Every wall of doubt will start caving in. Tears you cry will turn to victory. The sun will rise and soon your eyes will see. His name is stronger. Nothing is stronger.